And I'll start by asking a question. Why Marx spoke about workers of the world unite, the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class, why did he say the oppressed of the world unite? Why did he say the emancipation of the oppressed is the act of the oppressed? Why did he speak about the working class? That's the first question we have to ask, because it sounds absolutely elementary. People say perhaps he thought about the working class because the working class was big in number. And the answer is not true. When Marx wrote the Communist Manifesto in 1848, the Industrial Revolution took place only in England and Belgium. Therefore, the working class was a tiny minority of humanity. Tiny minority of humanity. As a matter of fact, even at present, my guess is there are more peasants in the world. People work on small plots of land, not in big units of production, factories, etc., than are workers in the world. The answer, he didn't look to the working class because of numbers. No, he didn't look to them in terms of numbers. Perhaps he looked to the working class because the working class was the most suffering section of humanity. And the answer is simply not true. There are people with lower standard of living than workers. Far lower. As a matter of fact, if you look to the Russian Revolution of 1917, the leading section in the revolution was the engineers of Putilov factory. Putilov factory was 40,000 workers in St. Peter, in Petrograd, highly organized workers. Their standard of living was far higher than millions of people in the countryside. He didn't look to them because they suffer, because he didn't look at the working class, you know, as the followers of Oliver Twist. You know, please give us more. Please give me more. No, he looked to the working class because the working class, he argued, is not a collection, but a collective. It's not a number of people, but a collective. And the difference between collective and collection is a very important thing, difference. You see, collection is in numbers. I mean, I remember in a whole number of strikes, you find the same phenomena. Workers go on strike, and somebody, usually the union bureaucrat, comes and says, you know what is important? Public opinion. What is important? Big numbers sympathetic to you. That will, is the real problem. Not the real fight, but the sympathy of big numbers. And I remember Mrs. Desai, perhaps you don't remember her, it shows you my age. In 1977, during the Gramvik strike, she's a marvelous little Indian woman leading the strike. She was fantastic. And you know what she said? She said, sympathy is like honey on your elbow. You can see it, you can smell it, but you can never reach it. Because you see, the number means absolutely nothing. Do you remember during the miners' strike, during the big demonstration in October 1992, when there really was a feeling of struggle? There was a feeling of struggle. We called for a general strike. What the TUC said? Let's get mass sympathy. They got the sympathy. Did it save one job of a miner? No. All the miners' jobs gone down the river. Therefore, the emphasis of Marx on the working class is the working class because it is collective. What makes it collective is capitalism makes it collective. They put together workers in factories, in big units. Unlike the peasantry, they are divided in small... That's why Marx, when Marx spoke about the peasantry, he said, the peasantry are like potatoes. The only way they can be united is put them in the sack. You know, there is nothing organic that unites them in terms of their own life. They can rebel, of course they can rebel. But the life itself doesn't put them in the same unit of production. That's why he put the emphasis on the working class. Now, what about the oppressed? The oppressed, there are thousands of millions of people oppressed in the world. Black people, women, gays, you can go through the list. And of course, it's part of the capitalist hierarchy, capitalist structure, that oppression exists. Now, why don't we speak about oppressors unite. I'm sorry, oppressed unite. Sorry, slip of the tongue. Oppressed unite. First of all, because the oppressed are divided into classes. As simple as all that, a black man can be a whole majority of them are very, very poor. Some of them are multimillionaires. The women are oppressed. But Margaret Thatcher is not my sister. You see, it is not, there are not one united group. It is not true at all. Not only this, when you look to the workers that are oppressed, the oppression increases their exploitation. A working class woman Because she's a worker, she's exploited. Because she's a woman, she's double exploited. Because her oppression is rooted in the fact that she has the task of looking after children, cooking, etc., etc., etc. Therefore, because of that, the double burden means her exploitation becomes worse. Not only she's worse for wages, but her wages are lower than the men. She has less opportunity to learn the skill because she has a break to look after the children. A whole number of things. In other words, the oppression increases the exploitation. But what about the rich woman? The rich woman said to herself the following. Of course, in the eyes of the law, I'm unequal, I'm inferior to men, etc., etc., etc. That's a fact of life. But am I really suffering from the oppression of women? No. Let's look at it a little bit more carefully. You say wages are low. Thank heaven for that. I can get my maid for a cheap price. Wages are low. The servants get low wages. I mean, for everything, it is marvelous that women are oppressed. They benefit from the oppression. You know, the women workers, oppression increases the exploitation. A rich woman, the fact is oppression blunts the exploitation. She doesn't feel terrible unhappy about it. A black person in Britain, you know the facts of life, he's worried about bad housing. That's a fact of life. 99% of them have terrible housing conditions. They are frightened from the police. I mean, I'm a white person, right? If my child doesn't come home at 3 o'clock in the morning, I don't give a damn, so he has a good time somewhere. You see, if I was the father of a black child, I'll tell you straight, I'll be worried if he didn't turn up at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, therefore, there's no question. A black person in Britain, the whole majority of working class people, suffer from lack of housing, from the police, etc., etc. When King Fahd comes to Britain, he is no worried about housing. He has so many palaces. You can't imagine. I read that he has a massive palace in Geneva with more than 100 beds, and he never even visited it. So now he doesn't suffer from housing problem. And when it comes to the police, I'll tell you, King Fahd is not afraid from the police at all. Because as a matter of fact, the police are under his control. And if you say he's crying all the time, oh, blacks are so suffering from oppression, Arabs are so suffering from oppression, thank heaven, I get them for cheap price. Therefore, he doesn't bloody suffer from oppression, he benefits from oppression. Therefore, to speak about all the oppressed because they are blacks or because they are women, they unite, it's a lot of bloody rubbish. A woman worker hates the bloody rich capitalists. If she's a woman or not, it doesn't make a penny difference. And a black worker in Saudi Arabia hates the King Fahd. You know, although he's not white, etc., etc., etc. This is the first reason why you can't speak about the oppressed unite. They don't unite in terms of classes. The class division is crucial. And when Marx says that the history of society is the history of the class struggle, he didn't mean that the only thing that exists is the class struggle. That's simplistic stupidity. There are many other things besides class struggle. But what the class division determines what everything else is happening. For example, my father used to say to me, I can sign a check in 9 languages, and the check always bounces. And then there is an idiot that can sign his check only with a cross, and it passes. Because the key division is not the knowledge of languages. The fact that you know a lot of languages doesn't bloody make you in control. As a matter of fact, Rupert Murdoch, the owner of the Sun, I'll tell you a secret. He is not William Shakespeare of the 20th century. I don't know if he can write. I'm sure he can write checks. Or if the accountant can write the checks. And then what it means, quite simply, that the class division is the determining thing. Now from that you ask another question. Are oppressed joining other group of oppressed because they are oppressed? In other words, do black because they are oppressed, join women because they are oppressed. Do women join gays because they are oppressed? Is there automatic connection between different groups of oppressed? Are they friendly to one another? To put it in simple language, and the answer is not at all. Not at all. And you know why? For a very simple reason. Because oppression by itself means that quite often you feel powerless in the face of the oppressor. And under such conditions, you know what really you do? You don't identify yourself with another oppressed. I mean, I learned it from experience standing in the bus queue. If you stand in the bus queue for the bus 106, right, sometimes you have to wait a long time. And I remember standing there in the bus queue, and the working class woman stands with me in the queue, and then the bus arrives at the end. And the driver was a black man. And the filth that came from those working class women, from their mouth, was absolutely astonishing. And I asked myself, why? I'll tell you why. Possibly this woman, right, I'm sure she doesn't have enough money. Possibly she quarreled with her husband. Possibly she lives in bloody high-rise building somewhere. And the baby was crying the whole blooming night. And she took the Valium and couldn't sleep. And she took it on the black man. It did not true automatically, she said to herself, I suffer, he suffers, we are friends. That's not true. I suffer, he suffers, I hate his guts. In reality. And when I remember, because quite simply, if you suffer and you feel powerless, what do? You find somebody below you to kick and somebody above you to identify with. Because it gives you a feeling of lift. People have terrible housing conditions. You live in a terrible cramped place with your two of you with four or five children, no space at all. What a marvelous feeling when you think about it on space. 8,000 miles away from here, my Union Jack is over the penguins. I mean, this feeling of the Falkland is mine. The Falkland is mine. My Falkland. For heaven's sake, my Falkland. I know where the Falkland War started. I didn't know what the Falkland Islands are. I'm telling you the truth. I knew it is somewhere in the south. But I didn't know it was the Atlantic or the Indian Ocean. I didn't have a clue where it is. But suddenly the feeling of lifting, you identify with somebody above you. I remember a working class woman in my street, comes into the street and says to myself, says, very excited, it's a boy, it's a boy. Because Princess Di had a boy. I turned to her and said, I have four grandsons. And that's a fact, my word of honor. I have four grandsons. She looks at me as if I was mad. This woman has a boy. I know her. Anyhow, my street is full of boys. I didn't count. But it looks half boys, half girls. So why the hell this working class woman cares about Princess Di boy? I'll tell you why. Life is so horrible and miserable. And therefore it is nice to feel that somebody above you is part of me. I identify with the queen or the princess, etc. And then, of course, somebody below you to kick. All right. I'm a woman. But heaven, I'm not black. I'm black. Thank heaven. I'm not homosexual. I'm gay. Thank heaven. I'm not somebody else. And we can go through the permutation. And you know the result. The result is a very interesting one. The worst racist, the worst anti-Semites in Nazi Germany, you know who they were? The gay, the homosexual Nazis. The Rehm and Strasser. And you know why? Because as homosexual, you are inferior. I want to explain, in the Nazi term, you are inferior, of course. Therefore, if you have a leather jacket, and a leather boots, and a swastika, how superior you feel compared to a Jew or compared to a woman? Therefore, the fact that you are inferior does identify yourself with other, so to say, inferior. I mean, I read somewhere about the Gay Association of South Africa. GASA, I think it is called. And this organization is pure white. Because it is not true. If you are homosexual, you identify yourself straight away with gay. You say, thank heaven, at least I'm white in this case. And therefore, it is not true. What I'm trying to say is this. The oppressed themselves are split into classes. The oppressed themselves cannot unite unless there is a feeling of power, of strength, that they can get out of the situation. You see, for me, the fact that millions of people buy the Sun at this rate is not that the Sun, the paper, the Sun is rotten paper. You have to ask the same question, why do they buy it? I go to my newsagent every morning and I find a pile of the funds, this amount. If in the afternoon I turn up, the pile disappears. I don't think they burned it. Now let's assume that some multimillionaire, I don't think he's here, came to us and says, here is £10 million, make Socialist Worker into a daily paper, charge for the Socialist Worker the same price as the Sun, 20 pennies, and I tell you straight, at present, if we had a Socialist Worker for 20 pennies, in the morning the pile will be like that, in the afternoon it will be like that. If you are far, you didn't notice that my fingers went a little bit down. And you know why? Because the simple question is, why people buy the Sun? And I'll tell you why they buy the Sun. If they feel powerless, they like those stories against God knows what, Irish, blacks, strikers, trade unionists, and they like the stories about the Prince Charles. I mean, for heaven's sake, Prince Charles, what a genius he is! What a genius he is! I mean, you couldn't bloody believe it! Why then you care about Prince Charles? And therefore, for us, we say even the oppressed, those oppressed, black workers are oppressed, women workers are oppressed. No, they will not unite with one another. They will not cross between black and women, etc., 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 unless they have confidence in themselves. And they don't get confidence except in the struggle. In other words, class struggle is the key to everything else. Key to everything else. I'll tell you straight. When people speak about the Russian Revolution, the thing that always excites me about the Russian Revolution is a simple story about Lunacharsky. Lunacharsky was a brilliant speaker. You know, a very cultured man. Lunacharsky, in 1917, used to have the meeting in Circle Moderne. It's something like Wembley here. There'll be 40,000 people standing there to listen to him. He'll speak for 3 or 4 or 5 hours. You know what he was speaking about? William Shakespeare. Greek drama. Now, you know, London is 4 times bigger in population than Petrograd. Petrograd has 2 million, London has 8 million. More people in London can read than they could read in Petrograd. You know, we are more cultured. Let's assume that Paul Foot, we organized a meeting for Paul Foot. Not on Greek drama, but even something nearer, Red Shelley. I'll tell you straight, there will not be 40,000 people. Certainly it will be not 160,000, there will be 2,000 people in the SWP, sorry for Paul Foot. This is reality. And you say, you know why? Because of a very simple reason, because the level of the struggle is so low compared to 1917, that they don't have those dreams, you know, of bread and roses. Not only bread is terribly important. But if you don't bloody have bread, you don't dream about roses. And this is the reason that for us, the unity of the oppressed comes through the class struggle. A few other points I'll raise and then I'll sit down. You know, the question comes from this. Do we need, because of that, do we need one organization for political organization for blacks, for whites, for men and women, etc., etc., etc.? What's our attitude to separatist organization? And at this rate, I am absolutely convinced that separate organization leads to a cul-de-sac. You know why? Because in the class struggle, you know, in the class struggle, unity of the people involved is necessary. I'll tell you what I mean by that. When I saw black nationalists in Britain saying, what we need white anti-racists? We can take it on our own! We can fight on our own! Of course they can fight on their own. Can they win on their own? It's a totally different story. Because you see, there's nothing more the BNP would love to have supporters of BNP, of course, are white by definition, and the opposition will be made only of blacks. That will be brilliant for the BNP. The propaganda will be absolutely marvelous. They'll go in the street to see only black people oppose us. Because they want blacks in power. They don't want us. I remember in a gay pride meeting, you know the gay pride, years back, we had fringe meeting, and I spoke about the need of gays and heterosexuals to unite together to fight against homophobia. And one gay chap said, what the hell we need the heterosexual? We can fight on our own. So I said to him quite simply, in Chile, when Pinochet, in 1973, did the coup and murdered thousands upon thousands of workers and socialists, etc., one of the first things he did afterwards, he brought the homosexuals, the gays, into Santiago, big football arena, and castrated them in public. So therefore, don't bloody tell me this bloody nonsense. Because I remember my father. Because I come from a Zionist family. I'm a Jew. My father was Zionist. My family was Zionist. And my father always used to say to me, who the hell needs the Gentiles? Who the hell needs the Gentiles? We can look after ourselves. And I said, there are only 500,000 Jews in Germany. How the hell you hold against the bloody menace of Nazism? And I knew it even before Israel came to power. Then whether you like it or not, unity is absolutely necessary. We have to unite. Separate organization doesn't work. But then people say, what does it really mean in practice? I tell you what it means in practice. The Bolshevik Party had a paper for women. That's true. But who edits the paper for women? Do you think only women edit the paper for women? They are wrong. Sergei was one of the editors of the paper. Bukharin was one on the editorial board of the paper. As a matter of fact, in 1916, when there was an international women's conference in Bern, a woman called Angela Balabanova, you know? That's the name, Balabanova. You know what she complained? She complained about Lenin. That Lenin stands outside the conference, and every time people go and discuss with him. What is bloody man doing about among you? After all, it's a women's conference. What the hell is he doing there? The answer is quite simple. If we really believe that you can solve problems individually, separately, of course then you should keep his nose out of it. As a matter of fact, the only people that know their own experience are the only ones who should deal with their experience. I'll tell you what I think. Marx, being a Jewish middle class from the Rhine, should write articles and books on Jewish middle class in the Rhine. He shouldn't write about the French working class, the British working class. He was not British, he wasn't a worker, he was not French. And of course, Trotsky must be completely bonkers. He writes about Britain, about Germany, about China, about Spain. What the bloody hell the man is doing? You see, that's why the sectionalism is a ruin of the whole... In principle, I'm against sectionalism. In principle, against separation. I don't mind at all to... Not only I don't mind, I support. I think it's an excellent idea to have a paper in Bengali in Britain. I wish we could afford it. I wish we had a paper in Urdu. I wish we had a paper in Gujarati. I wish we had more and more papers. Punjabi, I don't know all the languages. Of course I would like to have all the... But I tell you straight, it will exactly the same argument will be done in one as in the other. If you say that you'll use different examples, of course you'll use different. Because if you want to... Leadership is about the relation of teaching in a way. If you want to lead, you have to converse with the person you are dealing with. But I never tried to speak to you in Hebrew. Because if I spoke to you in Hebrew, I guess not that one of the bad person will understand it. And that's me. And therefore, I'm not trying to speak to you. Of course I have to adapt. And therefore, there's nothing wrong in making special paper for women, if we have a big enough base, special paper for Bengali, special paper for et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the idea of separatism is a completely different one. And one other impediment, of course, when we argue against separatism, people say, but you don't understand. Man does benefit from the oppression of women. He does benefit. Now, I tell you straight, if men benefit from woman oppression, I tell you straight, the idea of unity is a lot of bloody rubbish. A lot of rubbish. My argument, and when people say men benefit from woman oppression, they simply say, look at it. Men have better life. That's true. Even in working class family, a man has better life than a woman. That's a fact of life. He has a better life, so he must be benefited. I remember my father said to me, Germans, Gentiles, benefit from the oppression of Jews. Look, Jews went to the gas chambers. Germans didn't go. That's true. If you ask me, what is worse, life? To be a Jew or to be a German, I'll tell you straight, to be a Jew. If you ask me, what is worse, to be a man or to be a woman, I'll tell you straight, woman. It's much worse. No question about it whatsoever. But doesn't mean that men benefit from it? Do you think the German, millions of German workers benefit from the gas chamber? Do you think because Jews went to the gas chamber, German workers said, hooray, we are doing so well? No, exactly the opposite. The attack on the Jews was in order to break the resistance of the German working class. It is not that Hitler was frightened from 500,000 Jews. In a country of 66 million, 500,000 Jews are not the real problem. No. What he wanted to orientate, to find scapegoat in the Jews in order to dominate the German, the non-Jewish population of Germany, the big majority of them. And therefore, when you ask yourself, what you look on the face of it, It is not true that the German benefits from the Jewish killing of the Jews. Does a man benefit from human oppression? Let's put it simply. I'm a worker, my wife is oppressed, and I write to my friend, have you heard the marvelous news? My wife earns so little, I'm so happy. Now, if that's not good enough, you know they're closing the nursery, hooray! And you know, she's pregnant again, and we have no money. And there's no possibility of abortion. Absolutely, I'm so happy. I'm over the moon. Instead of coming and saying, the fact that she gets very little money is bad for her and also bad for me. The fact that there's no nursery is bad for her, bad for me. The fact that there's no right of abortion is bad for her, also bad for me. She suffers more than me, but I don't bloody benefit from it. The trouble was people see me say, but men benefit. They use the argument, but because it happened to me at the meeting, people say to me, but the fact of the matter, who gets up in the morning for the baby? Who does the work? The woman. Use your eyes. You can see that man benefits. You know, you can imagine George Bernard Shaw in his Jean d'Arc, you know, Joan of Arc. You know what he writes? He says, there's one who doesn't say that. Use your eyes. Can't you see the sun goes around the earth? Now, the honest truth, of course you can see the sun goes around the earth. Have you ever of you saw the earth goes around the sun? Put your hand up. Did you get up in the morning and say, I saw the earth going around the sun? Don't be bloody stupid. If what you see is what exists, you don't need theory, you need good eyesight. And therefore, if you don't know about men and women, you don't need any theory. You have to say quite to me, man is better off than woman, so the bloody woman, he benefits from woman oppression. White is better off than black, therefore he benefits. And the people starve in Africa. I say, my good God, how marvelous it is. They're starving. What a joy. I mean, for heaven's sake, instead of saying the same bloody banks that ruin the people in Africa, that bloody murder them, the same bloody people are controlling us, screwing us, etc., etc., etc. And because of that, the main argument from all this is a very, very simple one. The women, all the oppressed, first of all, we have to unite to oppress themselves around the working class. We can only unite those that are themselves belong to the working class, not the top layer of society. Margaret Thatcher will never join the SWP, believe it or not. However many articles we write about against women oppression, she'll never join us. I'm sorry to say that. It's a fact of life. Now, therefore, in reality, we have to unite them. We have to unite them not by simply saying there is separate issues. There are separate issues. Women have different issues they face than gay. A gay has different issues to face than somebody else. Of course there are different issues. There are 100 roads to Rome. There is only one Rome. You see, there are 100 reasons why you should be a socialist. I'll tell you why I became a socialist. I became a socialist for a very simple reason. Because in my bloody stupidity, at the age of 14, I wrote an essay at school. It was in Palestine. And in my essay, I wrote the following. Why there are no Arab kids in the school? There are no Arab kids in the school. Why there are not Arab kids in the same houses that we live? Why there are no Arab kids in the same street? Because the Arabs were the big majority of the population at the time. I'll tell you a secret. The first time in my life I lived with a Palestinian, Arab, in the same house was in 1948, at the age of 31, when I was in Dublin. You know, I had to go to Dublin to meet a Palestinian, to live in the same house. Now, when I wrote this essay, it's very short. You know what the teacher did? The teacher, and I'll thank her forever, she wrote underneath it, communist. And now I don't want people to say, the only way you go to communism, if you come, and that's why, then I found out in terms of that. Because unless you have Arab kids in your school, you cannot become communist. That's not the problem at all. There are millions of reasons why you become a revolutionary. There can be a question of oppression of Arabs. There can be oppression of your mother died early because not enough money. You can be millions of reasons. There are millions, millions of reasons. There are 100 roads to Rome. There is one Rome. There are 100 reasons to achieve a socialism. There is one socialism. The socialism will not come without solving the problem of the gays, without solving the problem of blacks, without solving the problem of Jews, of Irish, or of women, etc., etc. This is our argument, what Marx really spoke about the oppressed.